disciples he didn't love. What about Judas? Who in the world could love a man like Judas Iscariot? But the Word of God tells me that he loved his disciples, and he loved them all. Oh, he knew what they were. He knew that Judas was going to do what he did. The Bible clearly says that. And in spite of that fact, the Bible tells us that he loved them unto the end. He loved them. I think two of the most important things we want in life are, first of all, love, and second is to be understood, and I'll explain that. I believe, first of all, that you can actually deprive or deny a tiny baby of love, that a little newborn infant can be in an atmosphere or an environment where there is never a smile, there is no hugging, there are no kisses, there is no joy, there is no laughter, but just harsh, stern demeanor, and that that child can be slowly twisted and perverted and be denied some of the most important emotional development that could ever be given to a brand new newborn child. Love. On the other hand, in an atmosphere of love, parents that love the child and hug and kiss the child and are laughing and playing with the child, and this process called bonding takes place, where the child begins to really learn who is giving them love and who is giving them nurture and food and care and who puts them to bed and who wakes up and pats them on the little hand and makes them giggle and kisses them on the neck. And they respond. And when you smile at a little child, they smile back. When you grimace at a child, they don't know how to take it. They don't understand it. From our earliest beginnings, whether we like to admit it or not, and I've met an awful lot of very hard-bitten people, you look at them and their countenance seems to say to you, I have had a hard life, and I'm a hard person, and I'm not the kind of a person who's prone to fun and games, so don't try any laughter or any jokes or any happy-go-lucky or easy-going demeanor with me, because I'm not going to respond. I've had an experience in the last few days walking up to somebody who was coming the other direction saying, hi, and having them just go and walk right on, and I said in my mind, not out loud, oh, I'm sorry, I shouldn't have spoken, I guess. But then I thought, well, yes, I should have. And if given the same opportunity, I would do it again. We all need love. Now, when I say understanding, that goes beyond just merely understanding, meaning understanding our difficulty or understanding our needs or understanding us or knowing us. It goes to the word empathy, because at the worst times in our lives, when we are really in terrible trauma and trial, when we are lonely, when we're cold, when we're hurt, when we're sick, when we've been disappointed, when we're in trouble, when we're frustrated, when we're fearful, when we're apprehensive, when we're worried, and when we're depressed. And yes, I've been all of those things. And I've been all of those things very much in the last 8 months. And it's a difficult, hour by hour, day by day struggle to overcome those things. And guess who helps me overcome it? Jesus Christ, my wife, my children, my co-workers here, the wonderful people here at the home office, all of you brethren in the church, the ministry who have remained with us, all of God's people, the people who showed me such love when we went up to Morehead, Kentucky, and up to Springfield, and the people who write to me outpourings of letters that come in by the score and in their hundreds. I could start to mention names, and I won't do that. The other day, we took a picture, and Mr. and Mrs. E.B. Vance will mention that because I have the pictures back there for them to look at, because about 18 years ago, he handed me a little marble plaque that said, true friend is one who walks in when the whole world walks out. And he has his own plaque, and we stood here and took pictures of those plaques. And this gentleman has been a friend for a lot of years. In Proverbs 17:17, I'm going to come back to John 13 and 14 in just a moment, so I'll just quote this to you. You don't need to turn unless you want to. A friend loves at all times, and a brother is born for adversity. I think when I say empathy and understanding, and I define to you all those times when, as no other moment, at no other time in our lives, we desperately need someone to hug us, to hold our hand, to look into our eyes, and to say, I know what you're going through. I know how you feel, and I feel for you. I empathize. I've been there. I've had similar problems. I understand that. Let's go to the 13th chapter of John again and read again the last part of that first verse. Knowing that his hour was come, that he should depart out of this world unto the Father, having loved his own which were in the world, he loved them unto the end. In the 14th chapter, in the first verse, knowing now what was ahead, knowing what he was going to suffer, knowing what his disciples were going to do, you've all read the Bible, you know that, we rehearse it every single year at the Passover, he says to them, let not your heart be troubled. What an incredible statement. If I had been there, if you had been there, if we had been facing the incredible trial Jesus was going to face, if we were the ones about to be beaten and lashed and whipped, if we were the ones to be blindfolded and someone smash us on the face and say, prophesy, who did that? If we were the ones to have a crown of thorns jammed down on our head and tearing our scalp, if we were the ones knowing we would have to endure 17 to 24 hours of torture, if we were the ones who were going to die, would we be saying to other people, don't be troubled, don't be upset, don't be disturbed, don't worry, everything's going to be all right. Let's not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. And he began to tell them. And then he told him he was going to go, and they asked all these questions. It's amazing to me how some of them didn't understand. Look at verse 23. Jesus answered and said unto him, and Judas Iscariot was the one who would say, not Iscariot. Judas said, not Iscariot. Judas Iscariot had already gone. Lord, how is it that you will manifest yourself unto us and not unto the world? Jesus answered and said, if a man love me, he will keep my words, and my Father will love him, and we will come unto him and make our abode with him. That's speaking spiritually, but eventually, as it says in the 22nd chapter of the book of Revelation, the throne of God and of the Lamb will be in it. And God is coming home, and I used that as the title of a sermon one time, I think at the Feast of Tabernacles, that God is coming home to dwell among his creatures, his own creation. In verse 27, he said, peace I leave with you, my peace. That's a quiet calm, a calm assurance, a very untroubled knowing, a faithful quietude. Peace I give unto you, not as the world gives, because the world quickly takes it away. When they say peace, we can always quote Jeremiah, they say peace, peace, when there is no peace. And maybe it's another Middle Eastern ceasefire that lasts for only hours. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. What did they have to fear? He was the one who was going to suffer. But isn't it amazing that Jesus Christ knew that his suffering was going to cause them perplexity and fear, and that they were going to worry about their own lives and saving their own skins whole. And because he didn't want them to be scattered to the four winds, and he didn't want them to stumble, he wanted to reassure them, here is a kind of love that to me defies human understanding. It is so difficult to understand without just through faith saying we can try to understand the kind of outgoing love and concern that Jesus Christ had, which was completely away from himself and toward the individuals being loved. You have heard how I said unto you, I go away and come unto you again. If you loved me, you would rejoice because I said, I go unto the Father, for my Father is greater than I. And now I have told you before it come to pass, that when it come to pass, you might believe. Hereafter I won't talk much with you, for the prince of this world comes and has nothing in me. There's no connection. Has nothing to do with me. It's going to be an hour of darkness, and there won't be any more discussion. The time for talk is about over. But that the world may know that I love the Father, and as the Father gave me commandment, even so do I. Arise, let us go hence. Later on, he began to teach them again. He said, I'm the true vine. Notice in verse 12. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do whatsoever I command you. Henceforth I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth, but I have called you friends. And that beautiful song that was played before I began, what a friend we have in Jesus, reminds us that there is never a time that we will have to endure what our friend Jesus Christ endured, because he said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. He said, you have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you that you should go and bring forth fruit. I've written a brand new booklet, and I've written a third class letter. It'll be quite some time before that one is out, I think, but the booklet is being rushed to completion, and that is to be printed. It's already been written. It's called The Miracle of Pentecost, and I will be speaking about that at the Land Between the Lakes. But one point I want to make about that is this. There was never any time when Jesus Christ of Nazareth sat down with that group of 12 people and said, how shall we be organized? There was never a time when they said, how shall we advertise? There was never a time when they said, how far shall we travel? Where shall we go? How shall we put this? How attractive can we make it? How can we get people interested? What can we say to pique and to arouse their curiosity? But instead, by the power of Almighty God, in only moments of time, in minutes, at the most a few hours, thousands of never before converted, brand new children of God, new creatures in Christ, were suddenly brought into God's true church, and the church was born, as it were, in an instant, in but a moment of time. And it began like that. It didn't begin the way people try to begin churches and organizations today, did it? I want to ask a question because, you know, I've had many, many friends in my time. Do you think that Jesus had one relationship with John, and then when he got together with Peter, he and Peter discussed John? Do you think that he had another relationship with Peter, and when he and Cephas or Peter got together, they discussed James? And then James and John had a relationship, and when they were together, they discussed Peter and Christ. And then Jesus and James had a special relationship, but when they were together, they talked about Thaddeus and Simon. Now that's the way it is among human beings, isn't it? A has a relationship with B, and B has a relationship with C, and A has a relationship with C, and they share gossip about each other. I wouldn't want to say that men gossip, but on the other hand, having gone by a few groups of men and having been part of such groups myself in the past, having been around anywhere from hunting camp to locker rooms to card games, I can tell you that just like women, men gossip. That human beings gossip. That human beings love nothing so much as to talk about one another. I don't think that Jesus was that kind of a friend. I cannot imagine. It is foreign to my mind that there were moments in time when Jesus listened to one of the disciples telling him little tales, carping, getting upset with, and then agreeing with him, and thus developing a private, unique relationship with that disciple against another disciple. It cannot be admitted into my mind that Jesus Christ could ever have acted that way. I've acted that way. We have acted that way. That's human nature, isn't it? We like to think we have special relationships with special people. sometimes we don't know that their closest friend has a special relationship, and when they're together, they talk about you. We don't really realize that. You know, I used to have a lot of friends. J. Paul Getty once said, and he was one of the richest men in the world, he was head of an oil company and I don't know what all else, but he once said, I would give all of my millions just to have one happy marriage, because he had had several very unhappy and very failed marriages. Now, obviously the reason for that, multimillionaires have got to be very, very cautious, haven't they? We all know that story. That's the stuff of movies and novels. Because there's something those people want to get. What was it that Jesus Christ had that Peter, James, or John wanted? Well, it was charisma. It was a magnetic personality. It was leadership. It was his power. It was his teaching. It was his example. It was the fact that they respected and looked up to him. There were many things. But so far as material things, I don't think there was anything material that was there. I've said that I've had many friends. I still do, thank God. But the friends I'm talking about that are sitting here in this room, and the friends that will see this televised sermon, and the friends who have been writing me so many, many letters, are not people who want something from me. But I've had many friends in the past that I gave and gave and gave to. Trips, positions, things, responsibilities, favors. I could go on and on and on, but I will not do that. I learned very painfully that when you're up and when you're able to give, you got lots of friends. And I've learned that when you're down and you feel like you're near death, and you don't even know if you can go on for another hour, sometimes some of those same friends are nowhere to be seen. Let's go to Matthew, the 10th chapter, and verse 16. Jesus Christ told us very clearly, he sent his disciples out and told them the environment in which they were going to live and work. Behold, I send you forth as sheep in the midst of wolves. Be you therefore wise as serpents. And a snake is apparently very, very smart, very wise. It doesn't mean wise as the devil. Now, it means the way snakes will go seek birds' eggs in trees if they're a king snake, or a gopher in a gopher hole if they're a gopher snake. Wise as serpents and harmless as doves. Never wanting to hurt anyone. Never wanting in any way to cause anyone else to suffer. But beware of men, for they will deliver you up to the councils, and they will scourge you in their churches, in their synagogues. And you shall be brought, and that does mean under arrest. It doesn't mean red carpet treatment. It means brought, probably in manacles and under arrest, before governors and kings for my sake, for a testimony against them and the Gentiles. And when they deliver you up, take no thought how or what you shall speak, for it shall be given you in that same hour what you shall speak. For it is not you that speak, but the Spirit of your Father that speaks in you. And God is very, very powerful to be able to use any human vessel, no matter how inarticulate, no matter how uneducated or unskilled, at a moment in time, to give a very powerful witness, if he so chooses. And the brother, isn't this unbelievable? Have you ever seen families who have just fought, to where families have been totally estranged and where beloved family members won't even speak to one another? I have. Absolutely, I have. Seen cases where family members will not pick up the phone. They won't cross the room. They won't come to the telephone if they know a beloved family member is on the phone begging to talk to them. I know that there are who knows how many hundreds of thousands. And I've heard of some, and I've heard from some, and we've had on our prayer luncheons letters from some who are in hospices, old folks' homes, home care or nursing centers, and homes for the elderly, and have been completely abandoned by their own children, who never visit them and never call. And yet here were mothers who nursed their babies. Their babies are now 46 and off somewhere else in some other state, maybe having been married a couple of times and have their business or whatever, and their mother is maybe down in northern Florida in an old folks' home, in a nursing home, and near death and maybe crippled up with arthritis, and has to have someone else write her letter for her. And you hear of this wretched situation, and they don't ever call. They never darken the door. Now, that is merely human nature we're talking about. That has nothing to do with whether or not the mother knows God's word and is a Christian and is doing the work of Jesus Christ. It just has to do with human nature, that something in human nature that causes that kind of heartless abandonment and desertion of a loved one is just, it's there. It's innate in human nature. But it's amazing to me that a brother could deliver up a brother to death in order to save his own skin when it's time for horrible trials to be put upon people because of the work of God. And the father, the child, and children shall rise up against their parents, if you can believe that, to cause them to be put to death. That's an extreme that you can't understand. But if you've read some of the books that have been generated as a result of the Holocaust, if you've read some of the writings of Leon Uris, if you read about how the Germans would promise the Jews, who were like so many rats in the cellars of Warsaw, and then there are hundreds of thousands, they were completely entrapped and surrounded, that if they would come out, they would give them all these rewards and life and benefits. If you read about Majdanek and Auschwitz and Buchenwald and Dachau and Belsen, and if you read about those who became confidants and trustees who turned in their own Jewish brethren in order to survive. If you read about what people will do in order to survive, in order to avoid any kind of physical torment and privation and hardship, it is heartbreaking. And there were those, of course, who have committed suicide as a result of what they did because they couldn't live with it. There was the time when the ship Essex was rammed by a great blue whale about 200 miles off the Chilean coast. And the story is one that I won't go into in great detail, except that these men drifted in a ship's boat for so long as one by one they died. There was no further food. They were starving to death. And finally, when one of the last three or four, I forget, knew that he was nearing death, he begged them to drink and to eat him. And they did. And the captain of the Essex, who was finally rescued, who wrote of all of this, went home to Boston and later on committed suicide because he couldn't stand living with the memory of cannibalism. The man was not murdered, but he was eaten when he died. People, as God says, who were brought up in purple or velvet shall embrace dunghills. Isn't it incredible to think of someone who is accustomed to satin sheets, who is accustomed to a mansion and accustomed to maids and butlers and many, many servants, and accustomed to the finest of foods and the finest of clothing, could lie down in a little dingy cell and pile up some cow chips and put his head on them, and to be reduced to such a state in a very short period of time? Don't let me shock you, but let me tell you that by missing 3, 5, 9, 14 meals, missing that many, people with a thin veneer of civilization can be reduced to what we would like to say is the level of an animal, although animals oftentimes, unless they're a carrion eater or a predator, wouldn't really act like that. But take away the comforts, take away the pleasures, take away the safety, take away the lack of threat, take away all the conveniences, take away what we depend upon. When we turn on the faucet, we want water to come out. We hit the switch, we want the lights to come on. When we put the key in the lock, we want the lock to silently slip open. We want to walk into our home. When the car is going down the road, we certainly hope there's plenty of gas there. A woman especially doesn't want to run out of gas or have a flat tire along a busy road because she doesn't know what's coming along. All of our energy slaves, all of our conveniences, but when they are taken away, then what? What kind of people are we really? There are many who have given up family and friends. Jesus said, beginning in verse 34, "Think not that I am come to send peace on earth. I came not to send peace, but a sword. I am come to set a man at variance against his father." I've seen that in families. I've had many people tell me that when they began to study the Word of God, when they began to accept the truth of God, and they began to look into it for themselves, And they began to immediately try to tell their sister or their brother or their father or mother about it. They just didn't want to keep silent. Look, look what it says, Dad. We don't have an immortal soul. Here's what the Bible says. Maybe they were brought up Catholics. Their father looks at them like they're an absolute cultic idiot and becomes angry. And suddenly there is a rift, and finally it gets to heated words, and finally sometimes even comes to blows, and sometimes people are literally kicked out of homes, and sometimes people divorce. They will desert children. They will kick children out of their homes. Families have been divided. Jesus said so, and it's happened. It's happened definitely in my memory, definitely in the decades in which I've been involved in God's church and God's work. I'm come and set a man at variance against his father, and the daughter against her mother, and the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And a man's foes shall be those of his own household. He that loveth father or mother more than me, in other words, is willing to say, I don't care what it says in the Bible, Dad, if you tell me not to read it anymore, that's fine. You tell me what to believe, Dad. You tell me what to believe, Mom. I'll tell you what to believe, and you do as I say. But when it is a matter of personal conscience, if you do not love Jesus Christ more than even beloved family, flesh and blood kin, then he says, he is not worthy of me. And he that loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. But he that takes not his stauros, his great stake, and drag it along through life, and follow after me is not worthy of me. He that finds his life, now I've just found my life. That isn't what he's talking about. I'm alive, you're alive, here you are. It means he that actually will try to preserve and perpetuate his life in this rotten, filthy, sin-sick, satanic world and preserve it in material well-being, but jettison, reject the truth of God, reject Christ, reject God's laws and God's word, reject his way of life, and instead cling to a temporary, transitory, material existence in this shoddy world. If someone does that, he will lose it, meaning lose his eternal life. We're all going to die anyway. It's given to all men to die once. He's talking about losing salvation here. He that loses his life, not salvation, but he that is put to death, he that is in any way tormented, whatever happens to him, is put to death, murdered, assassinated, for my sake, shall find it. Because he had said in verse 28, fear not them which kill the body and are not able to kill the soul, soma suke, the life, the spirit, but rather fear him, God the Father, which is able to destroy both suke and soma, both the spirit and the body, in Gehenna. And that is Gehenna fire there, not Hades. God the Father is able to destroy the human spirit. God the Father is able to destroy that new creature in Christ that is begotten within us. He is the one we should fear, not human beings who, after they have done everything they can do to us, they cannot destroy that life, which is the new creature in Christ, which is going to inherit eternal life with Jesus Christ. Look at the 19th chapter of Matthew right quickly. Matthew 19. This is interesting, too, because of what Peter asked. This was the case where the young man had come and said, what must I do? And he said, sell everything you've got and come and follow me. But he was very rich, and so he went away very sorrowful. And then he gave the example of the camel passing through the eye of a needle in verse 23 and 4. In verse 27, Peter said, well, having heard this, behold, we that have forsaken all and followed thee, what shall we have therefore? So Peter's mind was on material benefits. It was on power and position, maybe wealth. What are you going to give us, Lord? We walked away from our fishing boats. We walked away and we've been traveling a lot. We've been with you. What are we going to get for it? Jesus didn't take exception. Could have, perhaps, but he didn't. He didn't use this as an example to rebuke Peter at all. But he said, verily I say unto you that you which have followed me in the regeneration, that is the restoration of all things, that means the revivification. It means regenerate, meaning new life, regeneration, a time of new life, the resurrection. In the regeneration, when the Son of Man shall sit in the throne of his glory, you shall also sit upon 12 thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. And everyone that has forsaken houses. When you have a house, and you've labored and worked and you've lovingly decorated it, and maybe you've had to re-carpet it a time or two, and you've had to paint it inside and out, you've had to re-roof it, you've planted all your flowers around it, you've worked in the yard, you have your home and your house. It can be the most important possession you've got. We have possessions, and they become very privileged to know, as I stand here today, I'm privileged to know that if I had the name and the address of a family or two in Savannah, Georgia, or in Moorhead, Kentucky, or in Sacramento, California, or Fairbanks, Alaska, and if I just showed up one day and knocked on the door and I said, I'm tired and I'm hungry and I need a place to lie down, they would not only invite me in, they'd probably move out of their own bed onto the floor and say, come on in, you're welcome. That's how you receive an hundredfold. Because you have hundreds, if not thousands, of brethren and sisters and fathers and mothers that will do the same thing for you as you, I'm sure, would do for them. Because that's what love and empathy is all about. Look at Matthew 26 and verse 47. Matthew 26, 47. They led him away. Peter followed to see the end in verse 58. Earlier, Peter had avowed that he was going to follow Jesus no matter what. He would follow him unto the death. He would follow him into jail. And Jesus had said, you're going to deny me three times before the cock crow. Here came these false witnesses, and finally they were buffeting him, verse 67, and spitting and smiting him with the palms of their hands. Prophesy, now who is it who just smote thee, they said. But Peter sat without in the palace, and this damsel came and said, you were with him, you were one of those. Didn't I see you earlier with this Jesus of Nazareth? But he denied before them all, saying, I don't know what you're saying. And when he was gone out of the porch, and another maid saw him and said to the group that was there, this fellow, he was with Jesus Christ of Nazareth. I know him. He's one of them. And again, he denied with an oath. Now he cursed and said, I don't know the man. But he was there at the Last Supper, and he was there for all of those 3.5 years. But now there was trouble. There was a beating going on. There was an arrest. Here was Jesus who had been dragged before the great authorities. And Jesus Christ was going to be very badly injured, if not killed. Peter didn't want any of that. So in order to save his skin, here old carnal human nature took over, and he rejected Jesus Christ. And again, the third time he did it. But of course, it says later on he understood, and his conscience began to kill him. And he went out, and he wept bitterly. In verse, 50. I think this is interesting. Back in verse 47 through 50, when he was still speaking, Judas with one of the 12 came, and a great multitude with swords and staves, and the chief priests and elders of the people. And he that betrayed him came up and gave them a sign, said, it's the one that I'm going to kiss, and walked up to Jesus, and that was common. They kissed each other on the cheek the way French men do today, and kissed him. And Jesus said, friend, wherefore are you come? What's your business? What are you doing here? And then they came and laid hands on Jesus and took him. I think that had to stick in Judas' mind. You know, I have, as I said before, have had many friends. And I don't want to say that it's always been a one-way street, because I'm sure that's not true. That would be a misevaluation. Type rating in the DA-20 Falcon. They couldn't give me a trip to Europe. They couldn't give me authority over others. I could give all of that to them. So it seemed to me, now maybe I'm wrong, but in retrospect, that it was like there was love flowing out from me, and there was, because I'm talking about love, unabashed, unafraid, unashamed, unreserved, without any strings attached, not wanting anything. Accept love in return. All I wanted was a two-way street. Just wanted to be loved as I was loving. Didn't want things, didn't want position or anything like that, because they weren't in a position to give me any of that. I already had it. It was there. It had been there since the 1950s. But you know, when you go for 18 years and then you have the experience again, and you go 18 long years with people with whom you've been so close, you have gone into a sauna after a very hard basketball game and sat there without a stitch on and shared stories. That's about as close as you get in a masculine environment. About as close as you get. It's about as close as you get in a hunting camp with your boots, with a great big outdoor fire, and your boots popped against a rock, and you're leaning back in an old camp chair and reminiscing about your boyhood and looking at the stars up above and sharing stories and swapping tales and just talking about life. You don't get any closer than that. But when you go 18 solid years and the phone never rings once, you get the message about this thing called friendship and about love being a two-way street and not a one-way street. So yes, I've had many friends. I want you to turn now to the 53rd chapter of Isaiah. I won't have time to expound both of these chapters. I wish I did, because the 53rd and 54th are absolutely beautiful, and I would hope that you would read through the 54th, because it is God's comfort toward all of us in God's church and toward Zion, which is Israel, and it's just an exalted, wonderful chapter of the Bible. It talks about Jesus Christ in verse 3. He is despised and rejected of men. And I have a sermon that I've done years ago called Christ's Lonely Sacrifice. It goes into that in great detail. We all know what it's like. I've begun to find out a great deal more. I found out in these last years of my life, and I found out in the last months of my life, what it's like to be despised and rejected of men. Am I comparing myself to Christ? No. I'm worse than a dead worm under a garbage can. I could never compare myself to one little passing thought of Jesus Christ. There's no comparison whatsoever. All I'm talking about is the feeling, because it says we have a high priest who can be moved and touched with the feeling of our infirmities. So we have a friend and a high priest in heaven above who, if no other human being ever comes to that point, knows the way we feel. I once read a little booklet, Where is God When It Hurts? It was in a waiting room of a hospital, and somebody had written it many, many years ago. But I know that then years after, when I had heard that story about the two twins that suffocated from carbon monoxide poisoning and were poisoned to death in their car in Alaska, and I wrote the booklet, Oh God, where were you when I needed you, is where that thought came to mind. When people hurt, they cry out to God. And sometimes it seems like because there's nothing but deafening silence, and you find yourself praying the same prayer over and over and over again, there's a temptation to say, is anybody listening? But you know, sometimes you have to see God through His handiwork, and in the faces, and in the love, and in the concern and the empathy of other human beings who are made in His image. And sometimes God's love is poured out upon you, not through some miracle, or because an angel suddenly says hello there, sitting in the chair across the room, which would scare us half to death anyway, but because God, through brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ, holds out His hand to you and says, I still love you. He was despised and a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from Him. He was despised, and we esteemed Him not. Well, not anymore. Not now. Not in this state of our lives. Not as converted members of God's church. Not as beloved brethren and sisters. When Jesus Christ of Nazareth felt life ebbing from Him, He was on the stake. Not only had all the disciples faded into the darkness and forsook Him, they all forsook Him and fled, but finally He cried out when He felt His strength ebbing, because spiritually He saw that God the Father had turned His back and, as it were, walked away into the universe. And He cried out, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, which is being untranslated, my God, why hast Thou forsaken Me? He died without a friend in the world. What a friend we have in Jesus.